Well, good afternoon. It's very good to see you all, and I'm glad that you're here. Obviously, you know, we wish it was under better circumstances, but we're here to honor the memory of Ron. My name is Pastor Austin Sharp, and I have the blessing of being the privilege here at San Marcos. And, you know, as a pastor, every now and then, you have the privilege. It's not a challenge, but you have the honor of pastoring somebody that could almost just as easily be your pastor. And, Ron, he would fit in that category. I've been here for a little over 2 years, and so I've been blessed by God's grace to get to spend a fair amount of time with Ron. We had we got to visit a fair amount over at the house. And, I would more than once, I'm doing the welcome, but I'm sharing while I have the mic. More than once, Ron in his chair would look over at me, and he would, with a smile, but a sincerity behind it, he would say, "How's your courage, brother?" And so here's this guy asking me how my courage is. And, what a blessing. It's been neat to see all these pictures of him, and thinking about, you know, the fact I only knew Ron a little over 2 years, so this is the Ron that I knew, inside and out. And I know that probably the majority of y'all have known him a lot longer. I'm glad that I got to know him pretty good in the last couple years, and I knew him to be devoutly spiritual. And we spent a number of prayers together, and I remember a couple of the elders would come over, and we'd have a little prayer session in his house. And I'm looking at these folks just like, man, let me just be quiet, you know, at these very mature people of the Lord, just that I just want to see what I can learn and get my blessing. Ron will be missed for sure. He's already missed. But I'm grateful that I knew him. And I want to tell you that he was devoutly spiritual, which you already know this. I don't know if I should share this or not, but I want you to know this, that this is, and I'm bragging on him now. He might not want me to, but I'm bragging on him now. Ron, this is how spiritual he was. You know, I understand that I knew Ron, and, you know, in a time when he had physical limitations that he didn't used to have, but he more than made up for those spiritually. And he expressed to me one of our last visits in the hospital, Elder Bill Lucas was there, that he was glad for everything that had happened in his life because of how close it had brought him to the Lord. Did you hear that? He said he was glad of everything that had happened because of how close it had brought him to the Lord. And I just want you to know that he felt that way and he had that outlook. I want to share a text here, and you'll notice in your program, it's in Romans chapter 8, Romans chapter 8, verses 35 to 39, Romans 8, 35 to 39. Paul wrote this, somebody who was no stranger to the challenges of life. Verse 35, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword?" 8:36, "As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." We're going to sing a song now as we get started, and I graciously ask you and encourage you not to let me sing alone. We're going to do a congregational song now of a very beautiful song called Pass Me Not. Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior, and the words should be on the screen. So please join in. Are we good to go? So wait. Yeah? What's that? Okay. Oh. Oh, okay. I see. Okay. I was waiting, my man. Thank you. You can tell I don't lead song service much. All right? Okay. Pass me not, oh, Savior. Everybody, hear my humble cry. Why? Just one verse. Thank you all. Hey, it was a pleasure to know Ron, and thank you again for being here. Thank you.
We certainly all use words in a variety of ways. And if you were to set out to try to write how God might think of human beings, it would be interesting to see the variety of notations that would come. It would be a worthwhile time probably to spend an afternoon doing something like that. But there's an author whom I do not know who that is, but I have the words of that author that I would like to share with you for just a minute and a half or two. And it's on the idea of you are special. And so I'd like for us to obviously have Ron in our sights, as we cannot do anything else this afternoon, and we don't want to do anything else. But one of the side advantages, I think, of these words is that you can grab some of these thoughts for yourself, because it's an author's idea of how special we all are. You're special. In all the world, there's nobody like you. Since the beginning of time, there has never been another person like you. Nobody has your smile, nobody has your eyes, your nose, your hair, your hands, nor your voice. You're special. No one can be found who has your handwriting. Nobody anywhere has your taste for food, clothing, music, or art. No one sees things just as you do. In all of time, there's been no one who laughs like you, no one who cries like you, and what makes you cry or laugh will never produce identical laughter and tears from anybody else, ever. You're the only one in all of creation who has your set of abilities. No one in the universe can reach the quality of your combination of talents, ideas, abilities, and feelings. Like a room full of musical instruments, some may excel alone, but none can match the symphony sound when all are played together. You're a symphony. Through all of eternity, no one will ever look, talk, walk, think, or do like you. You're special. you're rare. And in all rarity, there is great value. Because of your great value, you need not attempt to imitate others. You will accept, yes, celebrate your differences. You're special, and you're beginning to realize that it's no accident that you're special. You're beginning to see that God made you special for a purpose. He must have a job for you to do that no one else can do as well as you. Out of the billions of applicants, only one is qualified. Only one has the right combination of what it takes. That one is you, because you're special. I know there are tens of thousands of memories and thoughts, and laughs, out loud laughs or silent laughs, when we come to think about Ron Scott, or leading up in the last couple of weeks, thinking about this service. I want to be one of probably several that will say that he loved everybody, but boy, did he love his family. Don't have to work at saying that. Paulette, he loved you so much. And sometime before the day is out, I would like to have you tell me where you ever got that sweet little affectionate name of Bugs. Or Buggus, if he was in a hurry, I guess. I don't know which it took the longest to say. But he knew how to do it. And you seem to know what he meant. And Devin, Darren, Ronnie, your wives, your husband, the grandkids, wow. He had a story to tell. He had a story to tell about you, and he loved you so much. It was always interesting to see how he would never even think about slowing down among these two growing, rugged men. Rather like the challenge, I think. And Ronnie, you had your special, special place in his heart. And your years and hours of special attention, work, love, will never go unnoticed by anybody who knows the family. And it certainly never went unnoticed, unappreciated by your dad. And all of you, one of my favorite quotations is by a guy named Arnold Glasgow, who I know not one thing about. But he said, failure is not in falling down, but in refusing to get back up. And boy, did Ron know how to do that. He got back up in life at a time when some people wouldn't try to get back up, figuratively speaking or otherwise. Ron did. Things didn't slow him down. Because of your family and the love that you have, I remember, you know, 12 or 13 years ago when you sprung into action and did some refiguring of the house, did all kinds of things to make life easier and happier. And in turn, you just kept right on being dad. I remember saying to Ron several times, Ron, I don't think I could do what you do. He said, are you kidding? Are you kidding? I said, no, Ron, I'm not kidding. I couldn't do what you do. My first memory of Ron and Paulette was in the parking lot of the Southern New England Conference office. My office was on the second floor. And I remember this yellow, I think it was a Honda, small Honda, pulled into the yard, and the smile started and the friendship started and it never stopped. And all of us could have a long list of experiences. I'll share a few. One is that he came as educational superintendent for the Southern New England Conference, Massachusetts, Connecticut, and Rhode Island, of course, and I was involved in youth work at the time, and so our work just brought us together, as well as our growing friendship. And I think particularly of one day in Massachusetts, we had a large Pathfinder gathering. And I'm glad to see that this church is very active in Pathfinders. And for any who may be hearing this by some other means, Pathfinders is an organization similar to Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts with a little more spirituality in it. And they do all kinds of great things, helping communities, people, learning skills. But we had both been invited to go to this large Pathfinder event in Massachusetts, and we got there, and they treated us royally. And we were sitting on the front row, side by side, and the program had been going for a while. I think this particular one was an afternoon program. We'd had the morning, we'd had the fellowship meal like we've just done, and all these things. And so we were sitting down there, and one of the Pathfinder leaders said, "Elder Scott, would you please come up and lead us in the Pathfinder Pledge in Law?" So Ron gets up and walks up there. Then all of a sudden, the scary truth hit him that he couldn't remember it, or the order of it necessarily, if there is any special order. And he looked down at me and he mouthed the words like a dying cat. And he said, "Help me." Now, any halfway decent friend would try to help their friend in a crisis when you've got a packed church just waiting for the words of this leader from the conference office. There are two reasons why I didn't help him. One is I couldn't stop from starting to laugh so hard myself, but I was at least hiding down in the front row. And the other thing is I don't think I could have done it either. It's one of those things where those of you who are involved in Pathfinders, you know you've memorized it and know all about it, but sometimes, particularly if you don't keep at it, it's easy to forget things and get them twisted up a little bit. We were basically a couple of farm boys. Ron loved the farm, loved telling about growing up in the country, all the things that he did. Had a chance to be in Missouri a time or two with him and learned about some of the critters there. And he had me swimming in rivers that had things swimming around in them that we didn't have in Maine. And it's interesting because in Maine, people think about you people living in warm climates getting eaten by snakes. And we think, and you guys probably think about us freezing to death in snowbanks. But I guess I'd rather have more of a planned death in that way. We had planned on doing a number of things in life that we didn't do. One was we were both fascinated by livestock, cattle, and horses, and so we were very intrigued with auctions. And we had both long ago decided that we could do as good as some auctioneers we'd heard, which was basically not much in the way of a chant. You know, what'll you give me and how much? What'll you give me and how much? Well, we can do that. After all, if you were doing this for money, you'd probably get the same commission whether you had any little sing-songy thing or not, right? So we were so intrigued, and we sent away to the auctioneering school out west, and at least out west from where we were then. And we got the tapes. I still have the tapes. And so for years after that, even though we didn't go, actually, we would go, you know, be interested in auctions, and we would do it. And it would go something like this. He would call me, or I would call him, and, you know, if he would call me, he'd say, "Hey, $5 bid now, $25, and he'll give me $100 on this horse, and let's go." So we'd do that for about 15 seconds, and then we'd end our sale, and we'd get on with our talk. That's a good thing to do, isn't it, if you like auctioneering? One time, we found ourselves together at a time when I was needing the medical help, and he was there to encourage me and help me. And so one thing I needed was a shot every day. And I don't know how we got out on the trail without having my wife do it or whatever before. I don't know. But anyway, there we were. And so I needed this shot, and I wasn't used to giving the shot myself. And Ron says, "I'll give it to you." And I said, "You know how to give shots?" He says, yeah, I gave one to a mule once. You know, I didn't find that all that comforting. And I don't know if you know the backstory to one of these pictures on the screen or not, but he told me that he had a former student, maybe here today, I don't know. He said she had called him to ask if he would perform her wedding, and, you know, it's not uncommon to have that. And so he was happy to do that, and along the way he learned that she was marrying Kenny Rogers' brother. Kenny Rogers, for some of you younger ones, was a famous country singer not all that many years ago. Kenny Rogers was there. And that caused quite a little stir. Got some pictures, and kind of interesting. And Paulette, I recall Ron telling me that when he broke out in song as part of his service and started singing with Kenny Rogers sitting there looking at him, I guess you weren't overly excited. You thought maybe that wasn't the wisest thing to do. Kenny had no problem with it. Everything was fine. Well, I remember years ago, the Seventh-day Adventist Church wanted a series of history of Christianity leading up to the organization of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And so they commissioned the Australian Film Company to do this series. I hesitated whether to say this or not for fear that I'd be doing self-promotion for Ron and I. But since Ron can't tell you now, I want you to see it because I want you to see him. You don't have to look at me. You don't even know me, but you might like to look at Ron in the film. It's a six-hour production and all volunteer actors, and it started in Europe. You know, the Waldenses and the whole thing, and leads up to the fulfillment of a very significant prophecy that we believe has taken place, and it points forward to the fulfillment of Bible prophecy and the coming of Christ. And so we played a couple of different parts. They were most interested in, I guess, in someone that knew how to ride horses. And so if any of you do recall the film, or if you do look at it and you see us riding down a country road in a fall, beautiful woods road in the fall of the year, the leaves turn so beautifully. We were actually talking about a little bit about our faith and a little bit about our friendship. I remember specifically talking about that. Keepers of the flame. Don't forget, keepers of the flame. Well, Ron believed in all the teachings of the Bible. And I believe that he saw every teaching of the Bible a window through which he saw Christ. Whether it was prayer, death, or whatever, it just clarified his love for Christ and his understanding of Christ. In fact, Corinthians says all the promises of God find their yes in him. And so the Old Testament points forward to Christ. We got the Christmas story here. We got the life and death, burial and resurrection of Christ. We've got salvation by grace. Salvation by grace. Ron's very greatest desire was to have the privilege of spending eternity with his family, with his friends, with everybody that he could tell, and everybody that he could encourage. When you became Ron's friend, it wasn't just a passing thing. If he had any time to get your address or send you a beautiful handwritten note or a letter, he would do it. I believe the highest compliment that we could do for Ron would be to explore his faith, see what the depth of it was, and go into that same soil and really have that privilege of spending eternity with him. I was going through some things the other day, and I came across a Christmas letter that Ron wrote. It's 2004. And it sort of sums up a little bit about how some of us may feel today. He says, 2004 was a year of celebration as well as a year of remorse and deep regret. Now, why would Ron say anything about remorse and deep regret? He never really said those words very much. He tells about the happiness about in May of how Devin and Karen provided them with another granddaughter, Dylan. And in October, son Darren and daughter-in-law Shannon gave us yet another granddaughter, our sixth, he says. Raiden. And then he goes on to say, on the opposite end of life's continuum, my beloved father at age 94 passed away on October 14 after battling congestive heart failure for a year. We were all blessed by his life, and he died as he lived, peacefully in his sleep. And then the very last paragraph, he says, we are thankful for God's many blessings in spite of our great loss. Losing Dad makes us look forward to Jesus' second coming and the resurrection even more. Same to you, buddy. I've been asked to read a verse from Psalms. Psalm chapter 30 and verse 5. For his anger is but for a moment. His favor is for life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And we've got a song to sing at this time. It is well with my soul.
Thank you, Farley, Pastor Austin. It's great looking out and seeing friends and family at a time like this. It's, it's a wave of emotions that come and go that hit you at times when you're least expected. But I'm going to do my best. And I want to thank everybody for being here. We've got people here from Maine to Seattle to Colorado to Missouri to Arizona and all over. And I wish my dad was here to see it. He'd love it. So now that I'm of age, I've got to wear glasses so I don't lose my spot. But first of all, I want to talk about Dad's devotional book in the back. He wrote devotionals, daily devotionals, that I don't think hardly anybody ever got to read. So we put them in a pamphlet, and they're in the back, so please grab one on the way out. I think he did about 110 of them. He'd send me some, but we found them on his lap, or his iPad, and we put them into a booklet. Christmas time. Dad has favorite time of year. He always made it a special time for us. I remember those days going to Grandma Scott's house. I know Jimmy will remember that. My cousin's here. We used to go get on the tractor, go into the woods, cut down our tree, then do the old-fashioned popcorn strings and Christmas lights, and he always made Christmas very, very special. He loved his friends and his family, as Bob said, and that, you know, that's what gave him energy. He loved to be around people. My visits to my dad, I loved him, and all everybody's visits to him, they were never long enough. It didn't matter if you spent 2 hours, 10 hours, 2 weeks. He would always ask, "Are you leaving already? When can you come back?" When I was a kid, I used to dislike this part of it, but we were always the last people at church. Always, he would want to socialize, and he would never leave until everybody was gone. He loved making new friends as well. And he took a genuine interest in people, and I think that's why it was easy for him to make friends. And I think that was the connection that a lot of people have with him. Just recently, while he was in the hospital, you know, probably a month and a half ago, I walked into the room, and the janitor was there taking out the trash. And he goes, wait, Mary, meet my son. And he goes, Mary's been here for 17 years. She's worked at the hospital. She has two sons. They're 17 and 16. They go to the high school over here. She moved from Missouri 18 years ago. And I said, nice to meet you, Mary. But that was the way he was. He, you know, he loved people. And he said the exact same thing that you said from a standpoint, you know, his fate in life. But he loved being at that hospital because of the people. He goes, man, I really like it here. And I said, well, Dad, we need to get you out. We need to get you out as soon as possible. So, He lived by his favorite verse. It's, do unto others as you would want them to do to you. He didn't really care who you were or what you did. He was genuinely interested in you as a person. He wasn't judgmental. He listened. He only gave advice when asked. He kept secrets. He never gossiped. He became the confidant to many, many people. You know, people would call him from, you know, past, you know, experiences everywhere, including my wife. She claims she wouldn't have married me unless she had met my dad, and that he was, and she still says that to this day. And my girls too. When they had issues or, you know, were searching, they would call Rompa for advice. Dad loved life. He loved every minute of it. He claimed he never had a bad day in his life. I said, well, I know one really bad day, a really, really bad day. But he treated each day as a gift, you know. It was Christmas to him every day, even after his accident. And he was a super fun dad. He loved activity from motor. I mean, he was into everything. Motorcycles, rodeo, and bull riding, football, basketball, baseball, ping pong, horseshoes, leg wrestling, a choir, Pictionary, anything that could be a competitive sport. He was into it. And he loved doing it with us, his family. He loved doing it with Darren and I and then Ronnie when she came along. But he never let us win. So I remember that first day when I actually beat him in basketball. And a good buddy of mine flew in from San Diego. He was reminding me, he goes, I still remember those elbows from basketball where he'd elbow me in those. But I remember that first day I won. I was a junior in high school. Obviously, I was very excited about it and very proud. You know what he said after I won? Another game. Let's play another game. And it didn't matter what sport. He never wanted to stop. I remember one time he was a arm wrestling guy, probably half his age, and it went on for like 15 minutes. and they were locked armed. And to the day he died, he had a permanently curved arm because his muscles never released. He went to chiropractors, he went to doctors, he went to ever, but his arm was permanently cranked because of arm wrestling. He continued activity into his late 60s. He was still barefoot water skiing. He was playing flag football and basketball with men 40 years younger than him. We played in, you can see some pictures out there. We played in Austin City League football. He played until he was 67. Darren and I were both in our 40s. And the rest, besides a good friend of ours that was here today, everybody else was pretty much in their 20s. I was Pops, he was Gramps. But he didn't care, he loved it. And he, of course, he went all out. Every time, and this is a true story, every time he came back to the huddle, he goes, "Why didn't you throw me a ball? I was open. I was open." And I had to remind him that, "Dad, there was a guy standing right behind you. You couldn't see him." This continued until he had that tragic snow accident on a double black diamond slope. He was still skiing double black diamond slopes at the age of 69. But that didn't change his zest for life. In fact, it may have even strengthened it, as Pastor Farley said. But what really defined Dad was his faith and love in God. He lived his faith, and he showed it every day. Early in life, I witnessed that faith. When I was in third grade, and we lived in Kansas City. My dad was a principal, and we lived paycheck to paycheck. We went to Taco Bell once a month, and that was a special treat, which is why I still love Taco Bell today. We were short rent. Rent was $300, and we didn't have it. And for some reason, he had told us that. And he asked me to take out the trash in the kitchen. And I was taking out the trash, and there was an envelope, a white envelope, that was sealed that had my dad's name in it, in the trash. So at first, I pulled it out, and I gave it to him, and he got a little angry at me. He said, "Why are you throwing away the mail that you haven't opened?" And I said, "Dad, it was just in there. I didn't know about it." He opened it up, and there were three $100 bills in it. So we never found out, of course, where that money came from, but we had a pretty good idea that an angel put it there. Having him live close by was such a privilege. I mean, we got to spend most of my adult life with him, but especially these last 12 years, he was such a blessing. My girls got to witness what it meant to be resilient, what it meant to be a true Christian, and they drew very, very close to Rampa. As Farley mentioned, they also got to see what true selflessness was, dedication and pure love, witnessing my sister care for my parents. I know there's no saints, but Jesus close is one that I've personally known. My dad was a very particular man. He liked organization. He liked his hair perfect, even though there wasn't much of it. When I would comb his hair, he would correct me multiple times. He would say, no, the part over here, pat that down with water, even though he did barely have hair. So he planned this memorial service, speakers, songs, verses, all of it. But he wanted one last chance to especially thank his friends and family. He wanted me to especially thank the following people for their wonderful, caring friends: Rick Nossaman, Glenn Hawkins, Winnie Scott, Pudgy Bischoff, who's here today, Mike Hatcher, Denzel Leggett, Ernie Painter, Chubby Doles. You'll notice that there's a lot of nicknames in here. Bobo Buxton, David Hosted, Bob Farley, Mike Ortel, David Santos, and Wally Claridge. He also wanted his last message and focus to be on the brevity of life. How special each day is, and to make each one count, and most of all, that Jesus is coming soon. He was my dad, my confidant, and my best friend, and I'll miss him every day.
Bear with me because this is going to be hard, but I'm going to try my best here. So everything my dad just said is so true. My grandpa was by far the most influential person in my life. He was so thoughtful with everything he said and just showed me exactly how to live my life. I'm a sophomore in college now, so I've been away from home. So whenever I would call Rompa all the time, I'd be like, well, how are you doing? He'd be like, well, I'm alive, so it's a great day. And I was like, and no matter what I was dealing with at the time, if it was finals or tests, I'd be like, it's so true. And I would just look to him for that advice and that comfort, and he was always just such that person. And I remember I would send him like little photos of my day. I was just like, slices of life. They're like, look at this cat that I saw. And no matter what picture I would send, he would respond with this long paragraph, looking at every detail and being like, I love the crack on the, and I'm like, how did you even notice that? Like, it's just, and whenever I would FaceTime him, when I would go on walks, I go to school in New Orleans, which is arguably dangerous for a young girl like me, but I would call him when I would be on my walks, and every, like, 20 seconds, he would stop me and be like, okay, what street are you on now? And I'd be like, I'm on Maple Street, Rompa. And he'd be like, okay, what street are you on now? I'm like, I'm on. And I was like, what does he think he's going to do with this information? But that just shows truly how thoughtful and just what a good man and what a thoughtful and caring person he was. Every time I would call him or talk to him or see him, it was everything I said, you could tell, was really, really being listened to, and his responses were always just so, so, so real, and so he truly cared and truly thought about what people were saying, which is hard to find, especially now in these days. So I'm just so thankful that I got to have him in my life, and I will miss him and think of him every single day until we meet again.
So I'm going to have a buddy of mine from San Diego come up and say a few words. My brother flew into Houston and rented an electric car and made it halfway here. And he's in LaGrange. So I'm going to try to ring him up on the phone because he still wants to say a few words. But while I go get him, I'm going to have Bob say a few words.
Thanks, Dev. Well, I'm from San Diego, California, and I didn't know they had electric cars in Texas. So. I should warn you folks that I had no idea I'd be speaking today, but what a privilege it is to say a few things about my other dad, Ron Scott. Although my name is Bob Fleet, I consider myself very much a part of the Scott family. I am a brother to Devin and Karen. I'm a uncle daughter to Savannah and Dilly, and brother to Ronnie. So good to see you again, Ronnie, and Darren, of course. And I've always considered that a blessing and a gift in my life. I think maybe I should start with the day I met Ron. Over 35 years ago. I had heard a lot about him from Devin, but I had not met him yet. And there was two things that really struck me that day I met Ron Scott. The first thing I noticed was the immensity of his hands. This man had the largest hands I had ever experienced in my life. And when I shook his hand and my hand disappeared into that, you know, meaty paw, and then I eventually pried it loose, I think I could use the jaws of life to separate my fingers. And I think in that moment I knew who was going to be boss and who was going to be the alpha in our special friendship that spanned so many years. You know, the other thing I noticed that in that moment, though, was that there was something very special about that man. And I was too young and too lost, of course, to really understand it at the time. I know now what it was. It was the grace of God. Amen. It was the grace of God, and it was a kindness that surpassed anything I'd ever experienced in my life. And, you know, I was very lucky that I had a lot of epic men to look up to that were mentors and teachers to me over the years. My own great-grandfather, my grandpa, my dad, who I lost when I was 21, you know, mentors at work. But I've never had somebody in my life that was as godly as Ron. I think it's important to notice or to mention that Ron, in a way, was the most influential person and maybe the most important influence I've ever had in my life. And I'll share a little bit about that. You know, I've had a lot of brokenness in my life, and I don't mind telling you that. But there's always something about Ron Scott that caused me to question, you know, where does that kind of kindness and grace come from? I knew that it came from God, but I didn't know how to get it. I did not know how to get to that place. I had a belief, a general belief in God, but I didn't know that the way to God was through Jesus. And the one thing I love so much about Ron is he never beat me over the head with the Bible. You know, he never said, Fleety, because that's what he called me. He's the only human being that's ever called me Fleety, which I adore. But I knew, you know, I knew the way this man walked. I knew how he lived his life. I knew the amount of love in his heart came from a higher source. And because of that, he became a person that whenever I was in the most pain is who I reached out to. And for that very reason, and because I knew that, you know, there was something more that I needed a stronger, I needed a relationship with God, but I needed something more. And in 2020, in February, I got saved. And then in late February, I got baptized. And guess who the first person I called was? I called Dad. He's the only other man in my life I've ever called Dad. What a privilege to call Ron Scott Dad, to be part of the Scott family. You know, and I have so many memories of him, like Devin mentioned, basketball. I mean, that kindness went right out the window, of course. Basketball, football was involved. But he always did it with that gleam in his eye. You know, he had this kindness and this gleam that, like, it just was like magic. It just was something that drew me to him. There was so much love in his heart. And whenever we talked, it was like we picked up right where we left off. You know, and I'll never forget his words when I told him I'd been baptized. He said, "Oh boy, Fleety, oh, you better buckle in. God is going to bless your life, and he's got a massive calling on your life. And I am so proud of you, son." That's the kind of man Ron Scott was. He was there for me when I didn't have a father figure to reach out to on countless times. I'll always be grateful for my relationship with him. And I got to tell you, it's like he hasn't left, because I can't even think about sinning now that he's in heaven, okay? Because I have a feeling he's up there going, Fleety, no, no, no. No, we all know that's not true. If anything, Ron Scott's up there interdicting for all of us right now. You know, he's up there asking God to bless you, you know, putting a bug in God's ear. Hey, you know, can you take care of Paula? Can you take care of, you know, Dylan and Savannah and all the girls? And, you know, I mean, that's just who he is. I've never heard him ask for a thing. He was the consummate giver. And that man gave so much, it just hurt. I mean, the guy could give and give and then give some more. And we're all going to miss Ron. I am so grateful that I got to know that man. Thank you.
All right, we've got Darren on the phone. We're going to see if this works.
All right.
Does it work?
I think so.
Okay. Well, I definitely didn't expect this. Like Devin said, we are in the middle of nowhere, and you don't know what you don't know. And I'm driving a electric vehicle, and we pulled into a charging station, pushed it until it had 1%, pulled into a charging station. I plug it in, and it says it'll be charged in 8 hours. And I called Devin, and I'm like, oh, my word. I guess in the middle of nowhere, they don't have fast charging stations. Well, I've been watching, and I've been touched. And I want to start off by saying Ronnie is the favorite. Ronnie's not only the favorite of my dad's, but she's the favorite of Devin and mine as well. Bob, Dad loved you. Fleet Dogger, of course, Dad loved you. And I remember my dad and Bob Farley took a trip from Calhoun, Georgia after my son graduated from Calhoun. It was just Bob Farley and my dad in his van and his wheelchair, and it tested their friendship. It was a long trip, and if they can make it through that, then, you know, they made it through anything. Devin, I think you were a junior in college before you beat Dad in basketball.
No way.
Well, I wish we were there. Shannon and I are sitting here in the car. I wish we were there to hug each one of you. We love each one of you. I want to start by telling a quick story about my dad. When we were in a car in New England, and we were driving to a church Sabbath morning so he could speak in a church. It was snowy roads. You couldn't see. It was kind of a blizzard. My dad was driving at the time. There wasn't seatbelt laws. I was laying down in the back seat. And all of a sudden, I heard my mom go, "Oh, no!" And we slid through a stop sign into the middle of somebody's yard and plowed into a mobile home and wrecked into a mobile home. And, of course, we were freaking out, and I remember my dad ran to the door, and there was an older lady there grasping her heart and saying, "I need my heart medication. I need my heart medication." And my dad was like, "Well, where is it? Where is it?" And she told him and went and got it, and he gave her her heart medication. They got her daughter on the phone. Her daughter came over. And the reason I'm telling you this story, because with that type of event, even though it was a very negative event, we ended up making it to the church. My dad preached his sermon. My dad connected with those two people, stayed in contact with them, was a witness to them throughout many, many years. And it all happened because we crashed into their house. Well, I wrote something about my dad. And I started off with many qualities that he has. And some of them overlap with what Devin said. He was protective. He was loving. He was gracious. He was giving. He was honest, hardworking, athletic, responsible, loving, kind, neat, as Devin said, with his hair, even though he didn't have much, but I can't talk much either. Fearless. I could continue for a long time. My earliest recollection of my father was when we lived in Keene, Texas, and I was probably 5 or 6 years old. My dad was a stud cowboy. He loved cattle, horses, and all that stuff. He loved riding bulls, horses, and of course he was great at it. We moved from Texas to Kansas City, and there I remember going to Chiefs games and Royals games and playing sports with my dad, even though that we were young, I was younger. But dad was, I was starting to notice that dad was a pretty good athlete as a youngster. From Kansas City, we moved to Collegedale, Tennessee, and I remember going to my dad's AAA fast pitch softball games and his intramural basketball and football games. He was a stud athlete. I remember him saying, "One day I want to play with you boys and we can be on the same team. It will be a blast." After Collegedale, we moved back to Iowa, Missouri area, and my dad became the youth director of Camp Heritage. Well, my dad loved all his jobs. I think this might have been his favorite looking back through his life. He loved being Uncle Ron to all the campers and staff. He was like a father to many and a friend to all. He loved being on the lake with the staff and us boys, and loved showing God's love to everyone. We then moved to New England, then Spokane, Washington, and finally back to Texas. Dad loved every place and every job he had, as well as everyone he met. Dad was a go-getter and liked to do things. He didn't like to sit around. Dad and Mom moved in with us when my three oldest were very young. We lived on a lake, and we would ski and barefoot several times a week. My dad loved to barefoot, even barefooted when he was 69 years old on his birthday. He also loved to play basketball and football weekly. It wasn't until we moved to Austin area and Dad got his wish and he played organized football with his boys, as Devin told you earlier. We played in several basketball tournaments and softball tournaments before this, but this was the first time we played in a serious league together. And I'm telling you, it was serious. It was full contact flag football with some pro athletes and tons of current college players, or it was current at that time. To me, it wasn't a big deal having Dad play. It was just normal. But looking back, it was anything but normal. Dad was 64 when we started, and as Devin said, 67 when we ended. He was matching up with 25 and 30-year-olds. Even being a lineman at times against 350-pound All-American college athletes.
What does that say about us, you and me?
We weren't good kids putting him on the line. He loved it, though. Dad loved it, thrived. We won 2 championships in a row, even though the other team, they just couldn't believe it because we were so old. He also loved playing golf with us. He loved golf. Fast forward to 13 years ago and his accident. His life obviously changed. And while he was unable to do any of the athletic feats he was accustomed to doing, he shifted his attention to doing more of what he had already been doing most of his adult life, and that was mentoring people. He took to his iPad, emailing and Facebook messaging people, as well as spending hours on the phone with people. counseling or just being a friend. He loved his time with people. And so many of you out there right now that are there, you guys meant so much to Dad and those watching on live stream. He loved spending time with Ronnie and her family. And they were such a blessing to him and he to them. He loved his visits with Devin and his family and Karen and Savannah and Dylan. And he loved all of my kids and my family, although we weren't able to spend as much time with them over the last decade. I could go on and take every one of his qualities and literally tell you a story about every one of his qualities, but obviously that would take a long time. Dad lived an incredible life. Left a legacy that is hard to match by anyone. While it's not a legacy of financial success or worldly gain, it's a legacy much more impressive and important than that. His legacy is one of love for everyone, thankfulness for everything, and a Christ-like example in all situations. I can't wait to tee it up with Dad again into heaven. Love you all. Wish we were there.
All right, buddy. Thank you. So we were doing what Dad asked, right? In part of that, you know, memorial, you know, here's what I want. He says, I don't want it to last more than 10 minutes. So I don't think we're matching that one. So, but a quick aside, part of his particularness, I have to tell this about my brother. Dad had this old Cutlass, and I was already in high school in Sunnydale, and Darren was at home. He's probably 14, and he loved that Cutlass. He'd shine it up and whatever. And unbeknownst to him, Darren would sneak out in the middle of the night, take that Cutlass, and jump it across a bridge. And he did that multiple times, I would say a lot, because Dad would always like, man, I just got those tires aligned. I don't know what in the world is going on with this car. So, but luckily Darren survived. Mike.
I consider it an honor to have known this family. You don't find families quite like them. I would imagine you'd all agree. I just happened to be fortunate enough that our lives came together. Like Bob Farley, it was just the way the Lord set this thing up. To hear the sons speak about their dad is a little foretaste of what we have, because we never had that in-home competition and love. But we all got a bit of him whenever we were in his presence. I have never met a man quite like him, never will. The only one I could think of anybody better would be Jesus. His time with Jesus made him like Jesus, which loved us all. And I'm grateful. I had the privilege of being in the state of Massachusetts, having to go there like four times a year. And I had a sister and brother-in-law that lived there, worked in the same office as Ron and Bob Farley. And I would come for some meetings, and when I was at those meetings, Ron and I would meet. And when he'd look at me, and he said, now, this goes back nearly 40 years ago, so you know I had some hair then. But he would look at me and he says, Mike Ortel, you got to come to my house tonight. I got to cut that hair. So once I go there, and this is not a make-believe story, but this is true. The boys know it. I would come there, and the door would ring, and doorbell. I knock. Nobody would answer, and Bugs would come to the door, and I'd hear these guys going at it. Two boys against Dad. And Mama in the background screaming, stop this. Somebody's going to get hurt or killed. Somebody's going to put a hole in the wall. But he would take the two guys on, and oh, would they wrestle. I mean, it wasn't little tinker toy stuff. I'm talking like death do us part kind of thing. When it was all over with, and again, a lot of screaming. There was noise against the boys banging on everything, but Mama in the kitchen. But when it was all over with, let's sit down and eat. You know, like we just had prayer. Let's go do something. I'd never seen a family like that, that would give everything they got, heart, soul, and spirit, into whatever they did as a family. When it come to loving, they did that. And everyone displays love in a different way. Anybody else walking into that house would have said, oh boy, get out of here. It's the devil's at loose in here. But no, that was a godly thing. Never seen it since. But that's the kind of family it was like. So I get my hair cut, I got to know this guy, and then I get to know him on other occasions over the years. And, you know, that was started over about 40 years ago, and we still have stayed in touch over the miles and over the different things. We still kept in touch. And whether you're young or old, all of us need a cheerleader. I think we all recognize that. A cheerleader is somebody you know you can go to, and they're going to encourage you. They're going to love you regardless of what you say and what you do. But they have that sixth sense to know what's going on in your heart by just asking a few questions. And Ron would not know why I would call at times. But Ron was an extremely good, as it was already mentioned, counselor. A person who had that gift to know that you need a little loving, you need a little guidance, or whatever it was. And so I never told him that, but every time we got done seeing each other or talking on the phone, my cheerleader cheered me up. I'm going to miss that. He has asked that this scripture be read, which is found in the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 35, 6, and 7. Therefore, do not cast away your confidence. Don't cast away your confidence. Because if your confidence is gone, you know, you're starting to slip and slide. Do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward, for you have need of endurance, so that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. I can see why he would like to read this himself, going through life. And then in verse 37, it ends like this. For yet in a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. We all believe that, right? That's why he read it. He knew that Jesus was coming back today. And he would not want to have us forget, even at his memorial, for that. In conclusion here, I'd like to end with a little poem that I got when I was in South Lancaster, Massachusetts, when I was a freshman, and I had been turned down by many colleges and universities after high school to go on to further education. But I was accepted on probation. Probation, can you imagine that? My dad said, I couldn't go to college, my mother died, my brother went to college, I had to work on the farm, I've never had that opportunity. Your sister never went to college, but you're gonna go to college. And all the while I was growing up, almost every grade that I went next into, it was said on the bottom, Mickey is going on probation. Probation. We're all on probation, you might say, but there's always somebody in our corner. He was for me when I needed a cheering up. He was my cheerleader. This book is an encouragement to us. And this poem is what helped change my life and go from a non-scholastic kind of a person to go on and get one educational degree after another and another and another. God's in the spirit of miracles. I shall pass through this world but once. If there's any good I can do or any kindness I can share with any human being, let me do it now. Let me not defer it nor neglect it, for I shall never pass this way again.
I have traveled many moonless nights, cold and weary, with a babe inside, and I wonder what I've done. Holy Father,
thank you. It's been a blessing hearing from y'all about my dad, and it's encouraging. And I'm like Devin's mentioned, my dad would enjoy seeing all of you guys here. It'd do his heart good. And I'm glad that he touched your lives too, and that he hopefully pointed you to Jesus. Fine, right quick. So I'm just going to share some memories of my dad. I'm thankful to God for giving me my dad. What a blessing. At first, when I was born, my parents wanted another boy, so they cried when I was born. It's a fact. But they accepted the fact after that sometime. Them having me late in life and a while after my brothers were born meant that I got to spend lots of time with my mom and dad. They were my, oops, went to smaller. Hold on. They were my parents and my friends. My dad and I were close. He was my buddy, advisor, and dad. He was very active. Some good memories are when I used to plan out the Friday night worship, song service, and preaching, and my parents were my audience. I had a little pulpit. Some more good memories are of us camping, my mom, dad, and maybe some family friends. We camped in New Hampshire, in Glacier National Park, and Garner State Park, and Lost Maple State Park. And we got to hike in Yosemite and Sequoia National Park. And Desmond, who was just up here with me, my oldest son, got to go to the last two with them and I, but it was before he was 2 years old. We liked hopping on rocks and streams from rock to rock. We both loved animals, especially dogs. We rode horses together and went to a cowboy camp meeting where we got to ride by on horses and watch moose in a pond. We walked with my mom for exercise on streets and hills by their various houses. We liked water skiing, and we got to cross-country ski together and ice skate on ponds and lakes in New England. And he liked barefooting, me not so much, but I did it. My dad helped me with my vocabulary. I think he had a special interest in that, teaching new words every chance he could get. He also carried that on to my son, Desmond. I'm glad my boys have gotten to know my dad and become his friend and glean some wisdom from him, especially spiritual guidance and life lessons. Desmond enjoyed reading to my dad, and they would do literature homework together. My dad recently told him it was the best part of his day. My dad enjoyed Ronan's energy, my youngest son. I think it gave him energy just to watch him and listen to him. He is very active. And when my dad got paralyzed 12 years ago, that was a real heart stopper, life changer, and trial. But God brought him and us through that, and I'm thankful to God for that. And he lived another 12 years being a quadriplegic. That's pretty amazing. Praise God. He said if one person could be helped to the kingdom by his accident, then it would be worth it for him. I was his main caretaker for a lot of that time. He was particular, like with his hair and shirts. He said he still wanted to look nice and neat, even if nobody saw him. He was patient with me and flexible. He was a good patient, always upbeat and positive. A thing we liked to do since he became paralyzed was read together a devotional and a book and or a book. And I just liked having him around, him being there for life and family times, especially with our boys. I was taking his bandages off the counter after he had passed, and I was struck with the idea of no more of him dealing with sin and sickness. One of his mantras, which is actually a hymn, which I just found out this morning, in his life was, oh, say but Ron, he'd be like, oh, say but Ron's glad, oh, say but Ron's glad. But it's actually a hymn, but that was kind of his mantra. He said that in his life. And I need to mention that I haven't seen such devotion in a marriage as my dad was to my mom. It was God-given also. 59 years of marriage. Another thing that I thought was cute and true on his resume under his interests, the first interest listed was people. That was true. After God, that was what made the world go around for my dad, people, loving them, and having a friendship and relationship with them. I think the takeaway he'd want from his life and death would be to hold on to Jesus, to put God first and last and best in our lives. I love my dad immensely, and I so look forward to seeing him again in heaven, all whole and running towards me for a big hug and smiling his big smile to me and Jesus. Let's stay or get faithful to Jesus and trust in him fully so we can meet him there when Jesus comes back again. Amen.
I just wanted to say something that I wrote about him. My grandpa. I just wanted everybody here to know that he was the best man that I knew. He taught me so much about the guy I love most, and his name is my savior, my God, my Lord. Without my grandpa, I would not be the kid I am now, because he taught me about God.
All right, this is a poem for Ron Scott. I feel like it's a compilation of and a summary of what we've heard about him today already. Of course, we are here today to remember Ron Scott, who would never pretend to be something he's not. As we all can attest, his life was no fiction. Standing for truth was this man of conviction. No imitation here. Just simple and real, authentically genuine, a life full of zeal. For those who were near, you knew there was joy, smiling and laughter like that of a boy. A kid at heart, but beyond his years wise, with childlike faith, always young in my eyes. Ron wasn't just satisfied to do the required. An extra mile, no problem, even if he was tired. Ever quick to assist if there was a need, especially to plant a spiritual seed. I always felt welcome and never a bother. He was my friend, but much more like a father. To know he would listen was always so nice, a blessing indeed to receive his advice. When I think about Ron, more words come to mind, like loyal and loving, patient and kind, happy and cheerful. Rarely a grumble, open and honest, helpful and humble, dedicated and thoughtful, courageous, bold, and a smile that glowed, radiant as gold. Skillfully poetic, artistic indeed, and quick to encourage someone in need. A diligent worker, but never robotic, careful, creative, meticulous, methodic, musical, melodic, harmonic, he'd croon, and specially gifted to whistle a tune. Though wheelchair-bound, he was no less mobile, his head held high, still stately and noble. When it came to his faith, the lines never blurred, because he stood firm on his dear Savior's word. To all who would listen, he'd faithfully share the love of Jesus anytime, anywhere. To family, friends, and strangers the same, God's holy name he'd proudly proclaim. From his hospital bed in declining condition, Ron shared the good news to both nurse and physician. And there he was, strapped to a gurney, his last ride home in this life's journey. Another message of hope from this man on a mission shared with the emergency medical technician. To speak and to write about Ron in past tense just doesn't seem right for such a sweet prince. Soaked in sadness, the pain does persist when I catch myself thinking that he doesn't exist. 'Tis true he's asleep, still we must cope and answer the question, how hurt turns to hope. Indeed, he's still here and will never be gone. In our hearts and our minds, his memory lives on. You can be sure there'll be no more goodbyes. Soon Jesus will come, and the dead will arise. To awake from their grave, to shout and to sing, hallelujah, O death, where is thy sting? Off we will fly, through the sky we will soar, reunited, redeemed, to live evermore. Clothed in the light of eternal embrace, reflecting God's image, saved by his grace. The beat of Ron's heart in all of life's race was to meet his maker at last face to face, surrounded by loved ones and anyone so fervent to hear the words, well done, my good and faithful servant.
Devin has given me the latitude to invite our church clerk, Sister Martha Lynn, to do for us a resolution. Pastor Scott, as he was affectionately known to us by the Alpha Seventh-day Adventist Church in Austin, Texas. No one called him Ron. He was Pastor Scott. And not because he liked titles, but we felt like he was our pastor. And so at this time, Sister Martha, I'm going to invite you to read a resolution from the Alpha Seventh-day Adventist Church where the pastor is Pastor Grossner.
Resolution. In loving memory of Pastor Ronald Herbert Scott, we are today comforted by the words of our Lord in Revelation 21:4, which says, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." Whereas Pastor Ronald Herbert Scott passed from this life on November 25th, 2023, and whereas God in his wisdom has seen it fit to put Pastor Scott to sleep, too soon by our measure, but in the providence of the all-knowing divine, and whereas the pastor, officers, and members of the Alpha Seventh-day Adventist Church offer our sincere condolences to the family. We know that God does not make mistakes. Our sorrow is your sorrow. Your loss is magnified by the loss of a faithful servant of the Most High God. And whereas we have been blessed and honored to have the presence of Pastor Scott and his son Devin visit the Alpha Church in Austin under the leadership of Dr. Gordon S. Jones. Therefore, be it resolved that we embrace this bereaved family in our common bond of grief and remembrance of a beloved husband, father, grandfather, and friend. And therefore, be it resolved that we bow in acceptance of the perfection of God's plan to gather each of us who die in the Lord in his wonderful kingdom when Jesus returns. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be given to the family. In the word of John, chapter 14, 1 to 3, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you that I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, and where I am, you may be also. When the trumpet sounds on that great day of Jesus' return, Pastor Scott's eyes will open to our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Therefore, be at peace in the everlasting love of the Lord, respectfully submitted on this 16th day of December in the year of our Lord, 2023, on behalf of the officers and members of the Alpha Seventh-day Adventist Church, Dr. LaRon S. Grosvenor, lead pastor. Thank you.
I must be honest with you. Kind of wonder why I'm here. A few months ago, maybe over a year now, I got a call from Pastor Scott. And usually, while I was here in Austin, I would get these calls from Pastor Scott. And there were calls of just affirmation, encouragement. When I say this, I felt he was my pastor. And, you know, he understood what ministry was about. And so, you know, he would call me, affirm me after Sabbath service. He'd call me, we'd talk about my sermon. And he made me, except for Wendy, my wife, he made me feel like I was this amazing preacher and teacher, you know. And I know he did that for everybody. You know, I figured it out after a while. You know, I thought I was like the greatest preacher. And then after that, I discovered that, you know, he just affirms every person. That was just his heart, you know. I must be honest with you, like the bubble was, you know, like busted a little bit because I was like, I guess I'm not his favorite preacher, right? But anyway, I left Alpha and we kind of kept in touch. And then, you know, COVID came and so I lost contact with most people and everything. And I tend to, when I leave a church, I try not to get involved in the ministry anymore, you know, especially being there in Austin. I was there for like a long tenure, like almost what, 16 years or so. And so then out of the blue, I just got a call from Pastor Scott, right? Just out of the blue. And I'm like, hey, Pastor Scott, his number was still in my phone. So I recognized the number and, hey, Pastor Scott. You know, and he was like, hey, how are you? You're in my neck of the woods. You know, that's my area, Tennessee, you know, and we chatted. And how are you liking there at Riverside and everything like that? And then he said, I want you to know that, you know, I don't know who his buddy is. I really don't know. And if he's here, sorry, he said, you know, I had a buddy of mine. We committed that whoever goes first, we will utilize the other person would do the eulogy, right? So I said, oh, you know. He said, well, I don't think my buddy is in the condition to do me, so that's your responsibility. And I'm like, that's not what I was expecting, you know, like, hey. Because the guy I know, he was just so positive about life, and here he was kind of talking about the final moments, right? I was like, oh, Pastor Scott, no, you know, try to change the subject. He said, no, that's your task. I don't know if he's like that to you guys, but I just felt like I was commanded like this. I had to do this. I couldn't get out of it, right? And so, you know, when Devin called me, like, I was like, wow, yeah, I guess it's for real, you know, I guess. And so, I'm not going to be long, this is not black preaching or anything. I really am not going to be long. I'm not going to be long. Because that's what Pastor Scott wanted. He didn't want a long eulogy, right? So if it's too short for you guys, it's fine. If it's too long, it's mine. But this is what Pastor Ron wanted. And so I'm going to read a passage to you, and I won't read the entire passage again because I want to be short. So in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 11, 3 and 11, Ecclesiastes, the Bible writer wrote, he says, he has made everything beautiful in his time. Talking about God. He has made everything beautiful in his time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. That's enough. Usually when I do eulogies, right? I try to have a phrase or a statement for those who have heard me over the years. It's something that in those moments, because there's going to come a time, Devin, Ronnie, and family, that you're going to remember your dad. I lost my dad. And this is years now. And sometimes just the silhouette of a person or a voice just brings back memories of my dad. I've been walking through the mall, especially now. This was my dad's favorite time of the year. Well, we thought as a family, he was a workaholic. And so this is a favorite time. And just sometimes just something brings a memory back. And what is it I want you to remember when those times come when you think about Pastor Scott, Ron, Dad? I want you to remember three things. It's not anything profound. Just think about three things, Devin. Love, laugh, live. Can I ask you to say that with me? Let's say that together. Love, laugh, live. Okay, that's my, okay. Let me comment on it, right? So there was a document that was introduced in 1996 in Florida. It's called Five Wishes. Five Wishes. And this document is a combination of like a living will, health care, power of attorney, matters of comfort care, and spirituality. Each wish, there are five wishes, and each wish gives the ability to decide who he or she, number one, wants to make care decision. Number two, the kind of medical treatment that person would like. Number three, how comfortable they want to be. Number four, how they want people to treat them. Number five, what they want their loved ones to know. It's my task this evening for a few moments to talk about wish number five. What would one want you to know? I'm not making this up. He wrote it out. Devin texted to me. There are three things Ron would like you to know. The first thing Ron wants you to know is that life is brief and life is fragile. I want you to think about that with a moment. I didn't know I would have to do this, but Ron and I, we talked about this. Ronnie and I'm quite certain Devin family, Ron looked forward to retirement as a pastor. He told me that he looked forward to it, to that. And finally it came. He said he didn't realize it was going to be so quickly. Like, he felt like he was enjoying life and then soon he was retiring. And most of us here who are maybe over 40, maybe 50, it feels like life just slipped by one night while you're sleeping. Like you went to sleep and you woke up and it's like, wow, the kids are grown. I got pain in my back. My room smells like my grandparents. Like, wow, life's just gone by real fast. Life is fleeting so quickly. Ron wants us to know life goes by so fast. It's short. But also it's within that brevity of life is the fragility of life. Because I'm quite sure, because he told me this, that he looked forward to retirement because he was an outdoor man. He enjoyed life. And the fragility of life happened. He had an accident. And it changed his plans, but not his heart. Ron wants you to know that life is fleeting by real quickly. And within those moments, anything can happen. It's fragile. Number two, don't miss the moment. The philosopher L.C. Francois, he summarizes this wish. He says, a life lived in perspective does not presume on the future, nor does it miss the present. I like that. Because sometimes we are so focused on tomorrow that we miss today. Yesterday's a canceled check. Tomorrow is a promissory note. Literally, today is the only asset you have. How do you invest it? I think Ron would like us to invest it in family, in friends, to care about people. I don't know about you, but we're living in a world where it's just so selfish now. I had an example. I'm coming down the street. There's a detour. I cannot get out of the driveway unless someone lets me out. And ladies and gentlemen, the stoplight stops the cars. There is the driveway. So the person that is coming up to that intersection or coming up to that stoplight can't go anywhere. He looks at me in the eye and came and blocked me in. And I said to myself, how selfish. We're not going anywhere. As a matter of fact, I'm not even going in his direction. I'm going the opposite way. All he had to do, just give me a space and I'll get out. But we're so busy about tomorrow that sometimes we ignore those around us. Love today, live today, and laugh today. enjoy the moment. Finally, Ron wants you to know that spending eternity with God should be every person's ultimate dream. Can I say that again? Spending eternity with God should be every person's ultimate dream. You know, we all choose where we'll spend eternity. Spending an eternity is not something that just happens. You're making a choice where you'll spend eternity. The question is, where do you want to spend eternity? Have you ever thought about that? Do you want to spend it with God? Well, if you want to spend it with Ron, then you have to think about spending it with God. Because that's who Ron is going to spend his with. So for all those who said, I want to see Ron again, then he wishes that you would think about eternity, God, and Ron in the same sentence. Let me tell you something about eternity. You don't get a do-over or change your mind when you have lived your life not for eternity, but suddenly, oh, you don't get a chance to change your mind once you have stepped into eternity. So the choice is before you embark upon that eternal destination. This is the beauty about it. This is the beautiful thing about all of this, guys. Is that you can choose eternity right now. You can choose eternity right now because eternity starts with Jesus. And it doesn't matter your past. Doesn't matter what you have done. One of Ron's greatest wish were that every last one of you in here would have already made that choice or today made that choice. And this is the beauty about it. You don't have to do anything meritorious to spend eternity with Ron and Jesus. Hey, a colleague of mine, he tells this amazing story, Devin Ronnie, about his mom. His dad passed away a few months ago. And his mom called him, Devin, and she was like, hey, I got to go to court. And he was like, what, you'd have to go to court? You don't drive. You're a model citizen. Why are you going to court? He said, well, I got these notices in the mail, and I just ignore them because they were in your daddy's name. But now they're putting a lien on the house or something. They have properties. They have some properties in Detroit. So they're putting some liens on it, and they're going to lose the property. She had to show up in court. So she was all nervous, scared, because her husband, his dad, did all the financial things before he passed away, you know, and tried to just made his wife comfortable. And so she got up early that morning, early before traffic, and she got to the court house, and she got there early before anyone. She's sitting in the parking lot. Cars are coming in because she's so nervous. She's afraid. Finally, people came in, opened the court. She sat in the courtroom, I guess, just like you're sitting. And the judge took his seat, and the bailiff, or I've never been in court like that, so I don't know, I'm just making up names of individuals. So I guess the bailiff or the person who announces a name, they were like, let's use a name, you know, Gordon Jones. And she was like, hey, that's my husband. So she got up, and she said, I'm here. Judge looked at her, said, who are you? Said, I'm Mary Jones. He said, well, we want Gordon Jones. She said, that's my husband. He said, so why are you here? He said, well, I got these notices, and they're saying they're going to put a lien on our property, and, you know, I'm just here to figure out if I can, you know, get some time that I can pay these bills. He said, huh? Said, so where is Gordon Jones? He needs to be here. Said, he can't be here. He's been dead. She said, so why are you here? Because I got these notices for Gordon Jones. They put lien on her properties. He said, come here. She comes to the podium. He said, I can't charge you for Gordon Jones' bill. When he died, the debt died with him. You are free to go. Enjoy your property. Well, listen, this child of God. I let you know tonight that when Jesus died on Calvary, your debt died with him. You can enjoy eternity with him. You don't have to pay the bill. I'm making up my mind that I will make Ron's wish, number five, my wish. Spending eternity with Jesus is my one desire. And if that's your desire, guess what happened? You'll see Ron again. And I don't know. He's going to have super strength that time. I don't know who's going to be able to beat him in basketball, football. I don't know, because the Bible says he's going to have the desires of his heart. Amen. And winning for Ron was everything. Not winning for Ron was everything. That boy is going to win a whole lot in glory. I want to be at least a cheerleader. God bless you.
Again, thanks to everyone for coming. I'm going to have a closing prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for my dad and the life that you gave him and the life that you gave to us to be with him, be with us as we go our separate ways. Be and do what you want us to do. Pray all these things in thy name. Amen.